Establishing and upholding it. What? Huh? Wrong video. Oh, this is the intro video. Got it. Well, thanks for joining us this morning, guys. We're so glad that you've joined us online, whether you're watching YouTube, Facebook, however you might be doing it, we're excited you're here. More importantly, we are excited that next week we are going to be meeting live in person here at the church. We'll have the doors open. You're going to bring your own coffee, but it's going to be great. It's going to be an awesome Sunday. We're excited to see everyone face to face yet again. We just ask that when you join us next week, wear your mask, social distance. If you don't feel good, please, we'll still have online options available, but we would love to see everyone who's nice and healthy and ready to go next week. It's going to be a great Sunday. We promise that we're going to have all of the Christmas decorations down. If not, probably by June. We'll see what happens. It's going to be a great Sunday regardless. We're excited for that, but today is going to be great as well. It's going to be an awesome day of worship, praise, teaching, reflection. We're excited for today's service, and I'm going to pray for us to get us started before we get into everything else. So bow your heads at home with me, if you will. Lord, we love you. We thank you so much that this morning we get to gather here in your house, praying, praising you, talking about you, focusing on you, starting our week off with the most important thing, Lord. And so I pray for all that this morning. I pray for our service. I pray for the people who are sitting at home right now, that they will have a complete experience in you this morning, completely with your Holy Spirit, God. We love you, Lord. It's in your Son Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Yeah.
Let me tell you something about myself. I'm really not the type of guy that enjoys putting puzzles together like this one. I just simply don't have the patience for a 1,000-piece puzzle and put it together. It just makes no sense to me when I look at all the puzzle pieces. And if I didn't have a box like this in front of me with the picture of what the puzzle is to look like, then I would just see 1,000 pieces all scattered along the table, and I would become overwhelmed. And a word that would come to mind for me when I look at the puzzle pieces would be the word impossible. I just would not be able to see how all these thousands of pieces would fit together to make a beautiful picture. And so I want to ask, when was the last time for you that you used the word impossible? That things were happening in your life, there were situations, you were walking in a valley, and it was like a giant jigsaw puzzle with 1,000 pieces all thrown out on the table, and you just look down on it and say, impossible. And it's difficult for each of us at times to see the big picture, especially since we live in the age of sound bites and 280 character messages on Twitter. So when God is working in my life and in your life, and when things begin to happen that we might not really like, and God is taking some time to reveal to us what He's doing in our life, do you become impatient with God? We want to shout out to God, hey God, just exactly what are you doing? This is not how I planned it. The word impossible would come to our mind. And it's in those impossible times that we must go deeper in our faith. I like the fact that Luke 1:37 reminds us that when life seems impossible, God tells us nothing is impossible with Him. Now, I understand big picture living is tough for us to do, especially when we're living in the valleys of life, the pits, the fog, those dark moments when we wonder just exactly what is God doing in my life. We might even wonder if God really knows Himself what He's doing. And so it becomes hard for us to put the pieces of the puzzle together. Now, granted, when we get to see the end results of a 1,000-piece puzzle by looking at the box top, it's not so overwhelming. And so we get to look at the picture on the box top before we assemble the puzzle and before we get to put it all back in the box. The full picture of the completed puzzle is always on the box top. But unlike life, we always know how the puzzle turns out when we put it together. But in life, we know we don't. Putting a puzzle together, because of the box top picture, there are no surprises. But we know that life is full of surprises. This morning, we're going to look at the life of Joseph. He knew what it was to be in the pit of life. He had almost 20 years to have the opportunity to ask God the question, God, do you know what you're doing? God, I really don't see the big picture. I don't see how all these events and circumstances that are taking place, how the pieces begin to fit. You see, he had no box top to look at and see how all this would turn out. So the question is, how do you respond when life is happening and it just doesn't seem to be fitting into the puzzle of your life? Now, if I can be honest with you, there have been events in Karen in my life that have left me at times asking the question, okay, God, how does this fit into your plan for us? God, to be honest, I really don't like this plan. And sometimes we've gone weeks, we've gone months, we've even gone years before we begin to see the big picture, how God was taking those pieces and fitting them into His plan for our life. Have you ever asked yourself, how can this possibly be part of God's plan for my life? And God, if this is what you have in store for me, then I don't really think I like your plan. So let's look at the life of Joseph and see how he responded. We're going to be looking at Genesis 37, the first 9 verses. We find these words. Now, Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons. Now, let's just stop there. We know that's an issue, right? Issue number one. We know the story's not going to turn out well. Because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Now, Joseph had a dream. And when he told it to his brother, now, if we'll stop there, that's issue number two, right? He began to reveal to his brothers what his dream was. It says they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen, this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright while the sheaves you gathered around me and bowed down." His brothers said to him, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dreams and what he had said. Then he had another dream, and he told this one to his brothers. "Listen," he said, "I had another dream, and this time the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to me." Now, we realize Joseph might not have shown the best judgment, wearing his coat of many colors and telling his family not only one dream, but two dreams that he had, that they would all bow down and worship him. Now, I can just hear his brothers complaining to their father, Jacob, saying, "Hey, you gave him a coat. Where's my coat? Dad, you never treated me the same way." And then his brothers devised a plan. They said, "Hey, let's throw him in a pit, and then we'll kill him." But one of his other brothers, Reuben, said, "No, let's don't kill him. Let's just throw him in the pit," because Reuben had an intention of going back into rescuing Joseph out of the pit. But while Reuben was gone, his other brothers saw a traveling group of salesmen. And so they said, "Hey, we might as well make a few dollars off our brothers." So they brung him up out of the pit and they sold him into slavery. They then took Joseph's coat of many colors and they dipped it in goat's blood. And then they took it to their father, Jacob. And when Jacob saw it, he was devastated. He spent almost the rest of his life in mourning. Now, I can imagine that once they saw how their dad was in grief, they had what is often referred to as destination sickness. That is, where you arrive someplace you thought you wanted to go, only to realize you didn't want to go there. They thought the cover-up was a good idea until they saw the father's grief. They realized that they ended up in a place they really didn't want to go. The pieces did not fit like they thought they would fit. I'm not sure what they were thinking life would be like after they did this to Joseph and how Jacob would respond, but yet the puzzle wasn't coming together as they thought it should come together. So just a summary of the rest of the story. Joseph was sold into slavery. He was accused of rape. He was put in jail. He was forgotten about. And I wonder during those times if Joseph said to himself, "Why, God, are you doing this to me? I have lived for you, so why do all the bad things happen to me?" You ever feel like that? And when the pieces don't seem to fit, doubt and frustration will often overwhelm us. And I think doubt and frustration comes when things that I think should happen now happen later. Doubt and frustration will come when the things that I thought would happen never happen. And I think doubt and frustration comes when the things that I thought would never happen happen to me. See, from our perspective, it seemed like God had left Joseph in the pit. But the rest of the story is this. Joseph became second in all of command in Egypt. He saved Egypt during the 7 years of famine. And then his brothers came for food, and to get the food, they had to bow down before him because Joseph was second in all of Egypt. And that fulfilled God's promise, God's dream that he gave Joseph. Joseph made himself known to his brothers, and they feared for his life. And I think Joseph's response shows us that he had the big picture view. He had an aha moment in his life when he understood what God was doing with the puzzle pieces. In Genesis 50, verse 20, Joseph said, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. Max Lucado writes, Joseph tied himself to the pillar of this promise and held on for dear life. Nothing in his story glosses over the presence of evil, but quite the contrary. Blood stains, tear stains are everywhere. Joseph's heart was rubbed raw against the rocks of disloyalty and miscarried justice. Yet time and time again, God redeemed the pain. The torn robe became a royal one. The pit became a palace. The broken family grew old together. The very acts intended to destroy God's servant turned out to strengthen him. And when I look at the life of Joseph in this story, I'm reminded of a couple of things. First of all, God's promises do not carry an expiration date. When God gives a promise, he's going to carry it out. In fact, I like what it says in Isaiah 46, verse 10. He says, only I can tell you the future before it even happens. Everything I plan will come to pass. So be patient. Wait for God. Another thought that comes to my mind is that every turn, every event is designed to draw you and to draw me closer to God. Peter Kostebaum states, good times blind us, bad times reveal truth to us. And the last thought that comes to my mind as we look at the life of Joseph is that Joseph never gave up on God. And how could he survive when his life looked like 1,000 pieces of a puzzle thrown out on a table and it was making absolutely no sense? When all the doubts and the frustrations were overwhelming his life, how did Joseph never give up on God? Genesis 39, verse 21 tells us that the Lord was with him. Joseph knew deep down as he dug deeper into his faith in God that regardless of what was happening in life, the Lord was with him. So how does that apply to you and me this morning as we begin to take 1,000-piece puzzle of our life and not really having the picture to see what the overall design is to look like when it's all finished? So how do we continue to live when things just don't make sense to us? First of all, understand that God is in control. In Hebrews, we're given the promise in Hebrews 13, verse 5, never will I leave you. God is telling me and he's telling you that even when the pieces don't seem to be fitting from your perspective, understand this. God is saying, I am putting the pieces together even when you can't see it. Secondly, you and I can trust God regardless of the circumstance. You know, we have well-intentioned people that will come around us when we're in the valleys, when we're in the pits, when we're in the fog of life, maybe in a moment of depression, maybe anxiety is overwhelming us. We have well-intentioned people come to us and say, you know what, you're in this valley, you're in this pit because you've made a wrong turn. You obviously must be outside of God's will. And they will tell us that bad things are happening to us because God must be punishing us for something that we've done. But what I believe is this, it just simply means we're experiencing life, that we're in the valleys because valleys are part of life. And the last thought I want to leave with you is to realize that God works at just the right time. It took God working almost 20 years in Joseph's life for the puzzle pieces to come together and make a beautiful picture. The book of Esther, we find words such as, for such a time as this. Paul in Galatians tell us that at just the right time, God sent his son. You see, it's not how you start, but it's how you finish. Be patient and trust God. You see, he's molding you for a mission and for a purpose. Listen to what Henry Blackaby writes in his book, Spiritual Leadership. God is sovereign over every life, but those who yield their life to him will be shaped according to his purpose. When the Lord is developing someone, all of life is a school. No experience, good or bad, is wasted. God doesn't squander people's time. He doesn't ignore their pain. He brings not only healing, but growth out of even the worst experiences. Every relationship can be God's instrument to fashion a person's character. At times, through our most painful experience, God does His greatest work. I like what Ellie Wiltfong writes when she puts it this way. A jigsaw puzzle is defined as a set of irregular cut pieces of pasteboard or wood that form a picture or a design when fitted together. And this is like our life. Each individual piece is like every event that takes place in our lives. These pieces could be decisions we've made, people who have impacted us, births or deaths, changes in our families, the hard things, the gifts, and everything in between. So often in the day, we have trouble understanding the purpose of the hard parts of our life. We have a hard time accepting things that aren't comfortable and easy. This is a problem because when we wholeheartedly follow the Lord, life is guaranteed to be fulfilling. But nowhere does it say it's going to be easy. I love this passage of Jeremiah 17, verse 14. And I'm going to read it out of the Message paraphrase, and it goes like this. God, pick up the pieces. Put me back together again, for You are my praise. Now, maybe right now, sitting at home, your life feels like 1,000 pieces. You're like a jigsaw puzzle with all the pieces just thrown out on the floor, and you're wondering, how can I make sense of all this? Maybe it's your job. Maybe it's your family. Maybe it's the lack of resources. Maybe it's your health. Maybe you're going through a time of depression. Maybe it's broken relationships. And they all seem like 1,000 pieces. And because you can't see the finished product, you wonder what God is doing. And if that's where you are, let me encourage you just to be reminded of the words of Jeremiah. God, pick up the pieces. Put me back together again, for You are my praise. You see, God sees the big picture. Trust in Him, because like Joseph, the Lord is with you. Let me pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we're just going to be honest. There are events, there are times, there are days, there are weeks, there are months, there are even years that our life feels like a giant jigsaw puzzle with 1,000 pieces thrown out on the floor. We can't make any sense of it. But Lord, that is when we dig deeper into our faith with You. Because what we deem as impossible, You said with You is possible. And Lord, I pray for healing for those that maybe are lacking some peace today, maybe going through a time of depression, maybe family issues, relationship issues, maybe a loss of a job, maybe just not enough money. Lord, may they just seek You, and may they realize that every event, everything that is taking place in their life, You will use to create a beautiful picture. Lord, may we be faithful. May You use us. And may we realize You are always with us. It's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen.
So at this time, we ask you to take out some communion elements, whatever you've got at home that you can break bread and drink the cup that represents the broken body and the blood of Jesus. And while you're doing that, I just want to get you started in a moment of reflection. We're going into this new year, and I want to know, where are you at? How are you feeling? Is your relationship with Jesus different on January 1, 2020 than it was on January 1st, 2021? Where have you come in the last year? Are you questioning things? Are you doubting? Are you wondering where we're going with this? If so, I want to take you back to a passage of Scripture in Matthew chapter 11, where John asks a very similar question. He sends out his disciples and he tells them to ask Jesus, "Are you the one to come, or should we expect somebody else?" John himself, the guy who's supposed to be preparing the way for Jesus, even at this moment was questioning if Jesus was the Messiah. Is this really it? To which I want you to notice what Jesus says in response. He replies, Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does not stumble on account of me. Think about that for a second. John is asking the question of Jesus, and Jesus' response is, take a look around you. Look at all the ministry that's taken place. Take a look at all the things that have gone so well over this past time period, and let that be the answer for you. So this past year, there's a lot of great ministry that took place. There's lots of amazing things that happened, even just in our church, that affected the kingdom of God. Take a look around you if you have questions. And at the very least, look at this moment that we're focusing on right now. If nothing else, Jesus gave his life for you. This is what we celebrate during our time of communion. So if you don't see the amazing ministry happening, look at that sacrifice and know that Jesus gave his life so that you and he one day can live together forever. What an amazing God we serve. And so as we go into this time of communion, remember that sacrifice. Remember the amazing things over the past year that God has done. Reflect on those things. I'm going to open up with a time of prayer, but I'm not going to finish it. I'm going to let you and your family or you by yourself finish it at home, whether it's to yourself or out loud with the rest of your family as you go into this time of communion. So bow your heads with me and let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for what you have done and for the amazing God that you are. One who could ever sin.
Show me who you are and feel
Thanks for joining us today. It's been a great day of worship, a great day of praise, great day of study. I pray for you that this isn't the end of your spiritual week. I pray that this is the spark that sends you into more time of prayer, more time of study, more time spent together with God this week. And again, we're going to see you next Sunday. We will be here in person. The doors will be open. All that we ask, wear a mask, socially distance yourself from everybody else. And then finally, if you're feeling sick, please don't be afraid to stay at home. Think of all the other people who are trying to stay healthy during this time. We are so excited. We can't wait to see you, and I hope you have a great week. You teach me how to trust what's true.